Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. Today, we will talk about charges, orbitals, and vibrations and their interplay. So we will talk about work of four brilliant master students. It is all related to making charges or making triplet states with light. And this is, of course, extremely important for sustainable society, but also for photomedicine. We'll start with what happens with the charge separation and the spin orbit coupling if we twist around a single bond. That's the first question that we'll try to answer. And specifically, what will happen to the matrix element for charge separation, as well as the matrix element for spin orbit coupling, for this pyrene dimethyl aniline molecule in n-hexane as a solvent? These processes, they will both change. They will change in a complementary way, as you see here, maximizing at different dihedral angles. So here we see the squared quantities. This is the matrix element for charge separation in blue. This is the spin orbit coupling in brown. And you see that they have a complementary behavior. At, let's say, 180 degrees, charge separation is optimal. And at about 90 degrees, the spin orbit coupling is optimal. This is actually work of Shivan Bisazar. So he was able to calculate these properties of this molecule with DFT. We are actually talking about this type of process. If we have an electron donor acceptor system and we excite it, we basically get to the singlet and we can have charge separation. If the donor and acceptor have an orthogonal relationship, if the angle between them is roughly 90 degrees, the charge recombination can occur to the triplet state. And that is the process that we're actually discussing here. This molecule is actually one of the fastest molecules that shows spin orbit charge transfer interstitial crossing mechanisms. This molecule, it happens in about 40 femtoseconds, and it gives us the possibility to look at effects of a change of a conformation on charge separation and the charge recombination to the triplet. At the time we started, it was actually the fastest molecule. Right now, there is one that is 40 times faster. So we looked at the excited state geometries. Interestingly, if you start in the ground state and you go to the S2, then to the S1, and then to the T1, the aniline arm waves up and down. Excited state geometries implies that there's a small waving of the aniline arm. That's how we like to call it. These are the excited state geometries. So we have clear signs for charge separation, natural transition orbitals that you see here, the HOMO and the LUMO roughly, and also from the charge transfer parameters like the percentage of charge transfer and also the charge transfer distance, implying that this is really a charge transfer molecule and we can look at the processes with EFT. This is the way that the dihedral angle between the donor and acceptor was changed. So here you see the situation at 0 degrees, here's 90 degrees, and here's 180 degrees. Now, of course, you have to realize that this is basically what we would call in German a Gedanken experiment. We are just forcing the molecule to twist in this angle and calculate the properties as a function of this dihedral angle. In reality, there will be one preferential conformation. And here you see the change of the properties. The black line here is actually the minimum energy geometry. In the ground state, it's about 70 degrees. In the excited state, it doesn't change a lot. But you see that at this particular situation, the matrix element for charge separation is relatively low. Of course, it's much higher at 180 degrees because then the molecule is flat. But the charge transfer intersystem crossing, that is quite maximal at this conformation. So we looked at these processes in the gas phase in n-hexane and in acetonitrile, and they all give a very similar view. So it's a complementary behavior between charge formation and charge recombination to the triplet. So that implies that if you want to make triplet states by using this process, of course, you have to facilitate also the first step. That is what Shivan was able to calculate. So he was able to calculate matrix elements for spin orbit coupling and for charge separation for this system. And here in the acetonitrile, you see a strange dip in the curve. Now that's actually, we think it's an electronic effect because we see it back in a change of the charge transfer distance. This is the result of the electronic coupling. And here you also see the energy of the ground state. You see that this is the conformation in which we are looking at the molecule. In the other conformations, of course, the energy is very high. Altogether, we were able to set up a scheme like this. So we have a molecular donor acceptor system, pyrene dimethyl aniline. You see it in the top right. We excite it. Well, the single state energy is about 3.1 electron volts. We have charge separation. So the matrix element for charge separation is about 125 reciprocal centimeters. So that allows for very fast charge separation. We have a singlet charge transfer state and a triplet charge transfer state. They are very close. And from the singlet charge transfer state, we can get charge recombination accompanied by spin orbit coupling. And here the matrix element for the spin orbit coupling is about 2.5 wave numbers, but it's still enough. Charge recombination is about 40 picoseconds. And this is the energy of the triplet. So it also fits very nicely with experimental data. Things worked very nicely. So we were able to calculate electronic coupling, spin orbit coupling. We also managed to do the internal reorganization energy with the 4-point method. The solvent reorganization energy was basically treated classically, but there was one thing that was not working, that was the Wang-Rice factor. The values that we got for the Wang-Rice factor, so that's electron-phonon coupling, fibronic coupling, they were actually very, very low. And that doesn't really make a lot of sense. And it is a property that we really would like to probe. It is an important property if we want to look at charge generation. What is this Wang-Rice factor all about? That is something that you can wonder. By doing that, I will first start with a question. So please put on your microphone or open the chat. Put the chat open. And who is this? Does anybody know who this person is? It's a famous person.
Arrhenius, actually, I think.
It is Arrhenius. Yes, indeed. So this is a very, very famous person. Everybody knows the Arrhenius equation. I don't have to explain it to you, but this is Arrhenius. And indeed, Sonja already gave away the next question. This is Marcus. This is really Marcus. So basically, he got the Nobel Prize like 90 years later. If we take the Arrhenius equation and next to it, we put the classical Marcus equation, we actually see that they're very similar. So this you all know very well. So the pre-exponential factor in the Arrhenius equation, Marcus basically expanded it. He expanded it into a unit with the electronic coupling and also the reorganization energy in it. For the barrier, he used the Gibbs free energy and the total reorganization energy. So this is the trick of Marcus. So you see the similarity between the Arrhenius equation and the classical Marcus equation. But you may have heard that in the inverted region, the classical Marcus equation actually does not work very well. So that's why people came up with what we call the semi-classical Marcus equation or the Marcus Lewis-Jortner equation, and that contains the Wang-Rice factor. So that is this S here. And the S, it is the ratio of the internal reorganization energy and a vibration. So that is why it is correlated to fibronic coupling. So we are talking about the interaction of an electronic transition and a vibrational transition. So this vibration here on the right in the exponential term, that's the energy of the vibration that mediates the transfer. It mediates the electron transfer. That's the idea. And so this is the Wang-Rice factor, the S. And we really like to, we like to probe the S. We like to calculate the S because that is something that is in equations that are very similar like this here. This is very similar to the semi-classical Marcus equation. And you see, this is from the ADF side. So it is part of the DFT package. And you see that here, they actually have the spin orbit coupling matrix element. So that's what we calculated for the pyrene DMA molecule. But it's possible to also calculate the S value with ADF. And that's what we like to do. But the idea is that the large conformational change of this aniline arm, that is a problem to calculate the Wang Rice factor. It is, for other molecules, we have been able to do that. Laurens was able to do that. But for pyrene DMA, we get way too low values. They don't fit the models. And so we are looking for a new system that is more rigid. This is also the Wang Rice factor. So it's the same S here. It's part of the Frank Condon term, and it is related to the overlap of vibrational wave function. So here we see in black the dotted area, the black area that represents this overlap of vibrational wave functions. So that's what we're talking about, and it's important in making charges and also in making triplets, if you go into it. So can we calculate the Wang Rice factor, this S, for a more rigid system? That is what we like to talk about, we like to discuss about. And that is, we want to calculate the electron phonon coupling. We want to understand more how the vibrations interact with the electronic transitions, especially with the charge generation.